the night before. You wouldn't let me kiss you at your front door. Well, every time I get the chance, you never want to talk about romance. If I'm not really love, why must you make it up? Don't you know? Why can't you see that I know?
Thank you. Well, today is our favourite day of the week. Not only is it the start of the weekend, it's also Flashback Friday.
And during his five-decade career, Lonnie Lee worked with some of the biggest names in rock music and pioneered the Rockabilly movement in Australia.
Well, it's the one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready now, go, go, go.
In the 1950s, rock and roll was born.
Well, you can do anything, but take me off of my blue suede shoes.
And what followed was a golden period in music. The Rockabilly era was brought to life by the smooth vocals of Elvis Presley.
You still can find me for broken-hearted lovers.
And Johnny Cash's deep, emotional ballads.
Because you're mine, I walk the line.
Australia's answer to the Rockabilly movement came in the form of Lonnie Lee.
Ain't it so, ain't it so, well, I'm in love with you.
The performer shot to fame in the 60s after singing Elvis's Heartbreak Hotel on radio. Lonnie went on to produce 8 hit singles, including Ain't It So and I Found a New Love. He's also collaborated with Roy Orbison and penned songs for Cher. With an impressive career spanning more than 5 decades, Lonnie is still rocking his way around Australia. And Lonnie Lee joins us now. Welcome to the show, Lonnie.
Thank you, Matt.
How was it for you seeing that old vision?
Oh, it's so funny. It really is, you know. And yet, strangely enough, I remember the times. You know, I can actually remember being there doing all that stuff.
What was it like during that era?
Oh, it was exciting. The main thing was it was exciting because it was all new. And it wasn't just new for us. It was new for the audiences. You know, we'd go out and if we're on tour we'd go into the town, the girls and that would run out of the shops, leave their offices and chase us down the street and write their names all over our cars with lipstick. The whole thing was just so exciting.
Oh, wow.
That happens to me some days.
Oh, does it, Matt?
I'm not going to tell you where my car is.
You talk about touring and you did so with stars like Jerry Lee Lewis.
Mm.
But there was a story with the Jerry Lee Lewis about bit of a falling out. What happened?
Well, actually, in those days, the big stars didn't have suites and all that like they have now. Everything was all together. So on this particular tour, I and Jerry Lee Lewis shared a room on the different places. And we shared the same seat when we were travelling in the bus or whatever. So in this particular time, we were in a bus and he was next to me here and he said, we're going through the country. And he said, Lonnie, he said, what do you think of the country? I said, oh, I just absolutely love it. I'm from the country. He said, yeah, he said, I'm from Memphis as well. He said, I just bought 13 acres. I said, oh, that's tremendous, really wonderful. And he said, a couple of Cadillacs I just got as well. And I thought, oh, that's really tremendous. And he said, what about you? Have you been out to the country? I said, yeah, I'm from the country also. My parents have a sheep station. And he said, oh, really, how big is it? And I said, 7,000 acres. And he died. He got up out of the chair, nearly knocked his head off on the thing there and said, you effing, oh, I mean, really went off his face. Because 13 acres to him, I guess it was as if I was putting him down, saying 7,000 acres. Anyway, we made up later on and he paid me back because the deal was that we shared a room and whoever woke up first would wake the other one up so we could catch the plane. I didn't wake up. He woke up, left me there. He caught the plane. I missed the plane. And so I didn't miss the next show, but I got there. But when I got in, he said, I got you.
He did get you.
And he did get me, yeah.
You've written some songs with some big stars, including Roy Orbison. How did that come about?
Well, I went to Nashville to try and see if I could, my songs were going to be successful because it's, you know, very, very difficult business, especially then. And this guy heard my songs and he said, look, I think I'll send you to a guy who we feel is going to take Nashville from country, traditional country, into pop music. And because the sales of traditional country are going down. So his name was Don Gant. So he said he's the general manager of Acuff Music. So anyway, he sent me to Don. Don listened to a few of my songs, about 5 or 6, and he said, wow, he said, I can hear gold in your songs. And of course, to a songwriter, you think, what, are you kidding? This is my first meeting, you know. And he said, have you ever written with anybody? And I said, no, I haven't. He said, would you like to? I said, I guess so. It depends if the chemistry and whatever. He said, okay, I've got something in mind, because your songs are really international, and I know an international writer as well. I'll call you tomorrow. Anyway, he called me tomorrow and he said, how would you like to write with Roy Orbison? Of course, I thought, oh, you kid joking. He said, no, no, I'm serious. We've checked everything out. It's right. So he's arranged a meeting for Roy and I. So we had this meeting that ended up us being locked in the boardroom for 11 hours. But we got together for quite a number of
So many stories. And you've also lived next door to Johnny Cash. I mean, yep. The stories just keep coming. You're touring now, though.
Yes, we're going all over the place. We're going right through Queensland. We go to the Talangata, to say it right, 50s Festival next weekend. And we're all over the place. It's just wonderful. I'm just so blessed to do what I'm doing, you know.
And still to be doing it.
With my band. I got my own band, who are also my great friends. And so it's really, really wonderful. I am just so blessed. And I do feel sorry for some of these new guys coming along, you know, X Factors and all those different shows. There's not the future for them that I've been lucky enough to have, and people like my peers, you know, have had.
Oh, there may be. There's a few.
60 years.
One Direction, yeah.
We'll have to wait.
We'll see how One Direction is going
back.
In 60
I'll be out in 50.
Thank you, Lonnie. So nice to take that trip down memory lane with you. You can catch Lonnie Lee on tour. For all the details, head to our website. Now, if...
Ooh, I
1950s was a golden period in music. It was known as the Rockabilly era, and it was brought to life by the smooth vocals of Elvis Presley and Johnny Cash's deep ballads.
On your side, you give me cause for love that I can't hide. For you, I know I'd even try to turn the tide, because you're mine, I want the mine.
And Australia's answer to the Rockabilly movement came in the form of Lonnie Lee. The smooth-sounding artist produced a string of hits, including Ain't It So and I Found a New Love. And 60 years later, Lonnie Lee is still rocking his way around Australia. We're very lucky he joins us live at the desk today. Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
60 years, it's a pretty long time to be doing it. What keeps you going?
I guess my love of it, the passion of singing. I still love singing, and that's what started me in the first place to do it. So I like that. I still love the songs. That era is sort of embedded in me, so I still love all those easy listening songs and whatever. Yeah, just good. I'll never stop.
That's good. You can't stop. Everyone's got to keep going. It's awesome, Lonnie, because you play great music, mate, so there's lots of fans for you. You broke into the music scene in the 50s. You know, Elvis and Johnny Cash, as we saw, were really hitting their straps in the top charts. What was the Rockabilly era like?
Well, it was very new. It was very different. You know, for us, we were just doing things that we loved. You know, I guess just prior to the Rockabilly era, there was a very, very smooth 50s era. So everything was the crooners. And then when Rockabilly came in, which was just country sort of hepped up a little bit, it got to us because we were all young. We were just all teenagers ourselves. So that was all very, very exciting. And not only us as singers, it was new, but it was new to the audiences. And all the girls would go crazy and the guys. And it was just like the Beatles or the Elvis thing. It happened out here, the same thing. We couldn't go anywhere. We couldn't walk down George Street or Martin Place without being chased and girls riding with lipstick all over our cars and everything, we love you and all that stuff.
Good times.
Very good times by the sound of it. You wrote for also some pretty big stars as well, including Roy Orbison. How did that come about?
Well, I was in Nashville. I went to Nashville in 1971, and I eventually lived there for about 9 years. And during that time, I was there as a songwriter. So I went to one of the publishing houses, Acuff Rose, which is one of the biggest publishing houses there. And the guy listened to my songs, and he said, "Oh, wow." He said, "I can hear millions of dollars in your songs and gold." So,
good.
This is what a songwriter wants to hear, right? Anyway, I said, "Oh, that's fantastic." But he said, "I think the quickest way for it is maybe if we put you with somebody, a big international act, because you write international music." So I said, "Okay." He said, "Have you written with people before?" And I said, "No, never, just me." So he said, "Would you think about it?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Well, I'll call you tomorrow and let me know." So anyway, he called me tomorrow and he said, "Would you like to write with Roy Orbison?" And I said, "Oh, you're joking." And he said, no, I'm serious." So that afternoon we got together and we spent about 10 hours getting to know each other personally and found our chemistry was really, really fine. We had a lot in common. And so we spent the next maybe two and a half years writing and doing lots of stuff together. I was his personal assistant there for some time as well.
Fantastic. While you were also in America, you lived next door to Johnny Cash. What was Johnny like?
Yeah. Oh, he's a lovely guy. Very, very nice guy. Oh, and both of them, you know, Johnny Cash and Roy Orbison. They're very gentle people and very honest and true and with a lot of integrity, you know. And John, they were both sort of a little bit cheeky at times, John especially, because sometimes if I was out the front of Roy's place and it was right on the corner and it was all dirt and he'd come in his caddy, and as soon as he'd see me up near the gate there, he'd step on the gas, come around the corner, and all the dust had come up and stones, and so I'd be smothered in dust and he'd call back, "Gotcha," you know.
He really was a hellraiser, wasn't he?
He was, but a lovely guy,
Is there anyone you wish you could have worked with that you didn't? I mean, you've obviously come in contact with some pretty amazing, iconic people over the years.
I don't know. I suppose the only person that I don't know about work with, because he would have blown me into the sandpit, and that would be Elvis, I suppose, you know. But no one really got to work with him except in the very, very early stages when he was a support act, you know. But I never got to meet him. I was very close. I was invited to a party, and I couldn't get out of the jobs that I was at. I was in Illinois at the time, and I couldn't get down to Memphis, so I missed out, you know.
I know we've talked a lot about America, Lonnie, but how does it make you feel when guys like, you know, Billy Thorpe and Bobby Lloyd, you know, say that you inspired them in their music, Australian artists?
Yeah, well, that's really nice to hear that, because you feel that it wasn't all for nothing. Back in those days, of course, we didn't know that. We were just doing what we did. So it was quite a shock to me many, many years later when all these guys said, you know, thank you, and you were the first record we ever bought and the first person we saw on a show and whatever. It's nice to hear, but I guess in a way it's a responsibility. But when you know it's someone like Thorpey or any of these guys, Normie Rowe, or any of these guys, you know that they went to the top. And so if I inspired them just one tiny little bit, it obviously worked. Oh,
and you're still making music today, Lonnie. Well done. You've got a new record out, so all the best with it.
Thank
really
you so
nice
much.
To talk to you today,
Thank
mate.
Thank you. It's been
Real
my
pleasure.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
For
Thank
more
you.
Information on where you can catch Lonnie Lee performing, just please head over to the Daily Edition website.
in the car coach when we're late. I remember no one thinking of you. I remember your heart in the day of my car. I'm waiting in London.
If you'll give me just a 1 week.